And welcome back to the final leg of TORA's. Well, it was epic before. I don't know where it is now. 24 hours of Silverstone, the Britcar 24 hours. And with me in the booth should be everyone. But to begin with, we've got Matt Hunt, the TORA president, and also long time TORA member, selective rogue Duncan Ray. How are we all?
Not too bad. How are you doing?
It's been a long day.
It's been a long
time. And the rest. If you think this is long, can you imagine what next weekend's going to be like?
This is long. Imagine what a 48 endurance race is like.
There's a question for our viewers and listeners. Has there ever been a 48-hour race?
Oh, Duncan's obsessed with them now.
There will be. There's one that's been set up now. 48-hour endurance race. I think Adrian mentioned something earlier. The reliability, the modern GT2, GT3 cars, and modern cars
and LMP, especially the diesels.
Yep, it's such that you do need a 48-hour endurance race to really test them.
God. Awesome. Well, someone had to think of it.
Okay, so we're underway in the final stint. I think, first of all, I want to say huge congratulations and huge thanks to, obviously, Adrian's doing the commentary, Richie and Ian been helping out, Chris, Simon, and the guys also, and the XBR guys running the lobby. So I think things have gone a lot smoother this year. The way we've set the lobbies and getting everyone in and out, it's been excellent. I think, unfortunately, we've had still a few lag issues and a little bit of internet issues, but can control that. It's out of our hands. But I think it's been a really good event. I'm really looking forward to the last stint.
So with the final stint underway, we've got Lobby C, which is the only one that's majorly behind, I believe, especially on live timing. But I think it's about half hour after the checkered flag has fallen in Lobby A. We should be getting the results pretty soon for Lobby C. But as it stands, the fight for her black sheep, Ford GT, is out in front, 11 miles ahead of the M&M Racing Lamborghini Gallardo, and Hailfire's now black Turner Motorsports 994. That's 928 miles. In GT production, it should be the Hailfire Turner BMW taking the class win there. As we still not got the results, we won't know until we've had them. Forza Racing Hungary have been very consistent, have not put a foot wrong on 1,822 miles. On GT Club, it's the CQR Ignominy Civic, which is now 8 miles ahead of the CQR-ish VW. And with us in the boxes, one of the CQR-ish drivers, Christian Rose. It's been a long day for you too.
Hello again. It has. I didn't get too much sleep last night after a very long day. Up again. Free for the 4 a.m. stint, which turned out to be very long and painful. But we've finally made it to the last stint, and we're just looking to bring it home.
As are we. Now looking at the British Gamers Ferrari 458. That...
As we see a little bit of lag from the Hailfire car, it's getting extremely dirty at the front, but they have been keeping the numbers clean, and loads of lag from Drake Hillspont.
Oh dear.
Oh.
No, that's going to be loud because he's not.
Hopefully this doesn't affect any of the other cars as he's flying through walls.
No, I bet.
I think he's just going
to... Well, he has got a decent amount of space, I suppose, but this does not look good at all.
I'm really quite pleased I retained my comment about how reliability seemed to have improved for everybody.
Yeah, it's amazing you can go straight into walls these days.
Back with the Black Sheep 4 GT, Ferrari right behind it. So a special mention has to go out to the Forza Racing Hungary car, who a team have expressed their gratitude on the forums, appearing to be second in GT production class. The 007 Aston Martin, after its huge crash at the start of the race, is now looking at a podium finish.
I'll pause, but I'll mute myself before I start jumping for joy.
Obviously, we've got another stint to go, so everything looking good there. And for the final stint, instead of seeing everyone slam the brakes when we get to 1:45, it's going to be just like Le Mans. Once the time is up, everyone's going to complete their lap, and everyone's going to be sort of celebrating completing another 24-hour race.
And we were talking earlier on, Adrian, in the last stint, about how Britcar got on the last time they ran on this circuit. Now, not 100% comparable, because the weather that particular race back in 2010 was not ideal.
Muggy.
Yeah. It's certainly wind. I'd be more inclined to say exceedingly windy. The TSL live timing information has it listed as changeable. That's
For a 24-hour race in September, what do you expect?
Well, if it's anything like last year's, when it was baking hot and gorgeous, but unfortunately, I've just lost that page because I was scrolling down.
We're still going to be, whatever the case, we're either going to be in the shade or in the dry.
That race in 2010, the last to be run on the bridge circuit, was won by the Wit Gamski Enter 430 GTC. They completed 565 laps with the fastest lap of 2:01. That's so not the fastest lap of the day. So. 565.
Convert that into miles.
No. I don't do maths.
If you're looking at 565 laps, it's obviously been blitzed already in the lifetime enough to stint 11.
I was going to say, I mean, they've had perfect conditions, yeah, as always in the simulated world. But that was the fastest time that I've been in distinctly changeable conditions. I should probably go back a couple of years further, actually, to find the really hot year they had. But
Have a habit of doing is when it's really misty, they'd stop the race.
Stop the race, yeah. Which is what they did in 07 when Top Gear were running. 2008 was the first year I went, and that was really warm. I think it's 2008, I can't remember.
I really, really hope it is nice this year, like it was last time, but I've got a bad feeling it won't be. Not with the summer we've had this year.
Well, it's looking not too bad. I think the forecast is, if there is going to be any kind of weather, it's going to be on Sunday morning, but it's not going to be very much of it. Friday and Saturday is looking fine. I don't know how windy it's going to be, but certainly that in that with that regard, it's not looking too bad. Fingers crossed.
As we saw in our race just now, the Hellfire car is still suffering severe lag, jumping all around the track.
Oh dear.
Back with the Clubman battle, it's, well, wrapped up unless something severely silly happens to the Civic of the CQR Ignominy team. They are now closing down upon their counterparts in the Golf, the CQR Irish car. and it's now just a run for fun, and hopefully nobody gets damaged. Isn't that right, Chris?
Yeah, exactly. I think we've had enough damage to last us a lifetime in that Gulf.
How many panels are you through now?
Very. I mean, it's been a fantastic team effort by the CQR club. All of them have been very welcoming of myself as a member of VVV. They're very grateful for them letting me take part in one of their teams. They've all worked extremely hard on their cars, and I think it's really showing, especially in the Clubman class. We would have seen it in the Tora GT, but for that wheel failure in the late hours of last night.
Wheel failure, did it, was it as bad as what we saw with the Magic Tap Jaguar?
Oh, the damage to the Golf.
The handling issues, did you have no steering at all?
It was pretty difficult until I got it back to the pits. Managed to forge something just to survive to the end of the stint with a hammer. You know, following my usual trait of everything can be fixed with a hammer, some gaffer tape and some cable ties. Definitely seemed to work. We did lose quite a bit of time, but we're very pleased with second place.
Now looking at the fight for who Acura, which is still trying to make a comeback from a few disconnection issues. It is now up to 24th. Oh, it's looking at 24th place on a projected mileage in lobby. Currently running on 1599 miles.
Right, Adrian, have you got the good news or the bad news?
Both, please.
Well, I've gone to my my favourite weather checking site, metcheck.com. Other websites are available but probably aren't as good. Friday, warmish, breezy, possible showers.
Possible showers. Otherwise, it might not be possible.
Yeah, in the evening, however, 4.6 mil of rain, so definite showers in the evening. So night qualifying, 16, most likely is going to be damp.
16 mil of rain.
4.6.
4.6 mil of rain, so 5 centimetres.
That's quite a bit.
As long as we get it in one go, that 6 centimetre layer of water just to go splosh, and then we're fine. So that's nothing.
Yeah, I said just someone drop a bucket on the weather meter, that'd be fine. Saturday is looking fine until the evening again. 8 degrees, stronger wind, 8.3 mil of rain. Great. And Sunday is looking fine again. So looks to me like any rain that's going to be had at the circuit is going to be in the evening times overnight. So theoretically, the daytime stuff should be fine.
Just one splosh is all it takes. Anyway, let's look at how many laps everyone's done.
So that's your updated weather forecast for next weekend, people. What's a bit of rain in this country, eh?
A lot.
As we continue to watch the CQR Jaguar circulating, it's making its way through the club now, and onto the farm straight, the new Abbey pit lane straight, just without the wing and all the stuff. Just to ruin the imagery for you, the circuit is actually now 9 years out of date.
9 years.
The circuit is modelled on Silverstone as it was in 2003.
Wow, that's quite far along.
It might even, there's parts of it that are actually modelled on how it was in 2000, which is even worse.
It's not good. Anyway, the CQR Bulldogs, 1787 miles, 559 laps after stint 11, and looking at a 14th place finish overall after a big crash in stint 3. Also recovering the Vodafone British Gamers car after a big crash in stint 5. Actually, no, they completely disconnected in stint 5. They had nothing to do with the big crash from the pit lane straight, which took about 3 or 4 of the cars. Those continued, but Vodafone British Gamers, while ahead of that pack, must have just disconnected. So they're looking at 13th overall once the checkered flag falls. And there's the Hailfire BMW again with its lag just side by side with the British Gamers car, so remain scarce British Gamers. It may look like it's driving you off the track, but it's unfortunately the Atlantic is fiddling with its connection, so to speak.
Yes, the Atlantic is rather large.
Now then, Cool G84, the Hungarian racing, sorry, we always keep saying this wrong, Forza Racing Hungary, 570 laps as of stint 11, 570 laps after stint 11, 557 laps for the Aston Martin 007 car, which has recovered gracefully to be on a podium potentially come the end of the race. So to summarise for the overall win, it was down to FOH Black Sheep, who were leading from the start, did have a minor slip up in the 5th and 6th hour of the race when the Vodafone British Gamers car took the lead, but then fight for her clawed back and have remained in the lead ever since, knocking in over 170 miles every single time. For second place, there have been 4 cars in second place, including the Vodafone and Black Sheep car, Rogue BMW, which are running in Lobby B, and also M&M Racing, who currently hold second place. In production GT, that's been all over the place since the start. You did have the dynamic racing Acura was leading in the start. Then it was handed over to the Fight for Her Acura, which dropped out of Lobby A in the early hours. The lead then passed to the Nürburgracer Aston for about 6 hours before that had issues. And now it's down to the Hailfire Turner BMW, which was leading. It probably still is, but we still haven't had any updates on live timing from Lobby C. As for Clubman, which should be close, however, one of the best teams in TORA have put a stranglehold on that class in the Ignominy Civic, which we're currently looking at, and also the CQ Irish Golf, all banging in at least 154 miles every single time, not getting any higher than 156. So 534 laps for the Civic and 532 laps for the Golf. Now looking at the British Gamers Talbot, or we were. We're now back with the Richie, stop messing about.
Sorry. Every time you say I'm watching, I've just started switching around. The Clubman car is still really close. The before we went into this, the CQR-ish car was about 9 miles behind, so that was about two laps behind the Civic, so a little bit to work on. Civic did look a little bit battered, I have to say. It was a nice big hole in the middle of the boot.
Say 8 miles, so you got 2.5 laps to gain ground on them and to potentially take the lead there, Christian. Do you think that's likely?
Well, anything can happen. So there's a slight chance, but I don't really think so.
Currently in the GT class, Face Palmer seems to be
for a close formula like the Clubman class, which
Face Palmer seems to be taking his time in this stint. Seems to be just doesn't want to mess anything up, keep the car clean, staying away from the likes of the slightly laggy cars. Hailfire car seems to be a lot better now. The lag seems to have died off. Still a little bit jumpy, but not as bad as it was.
So whatever he's managed to do on the fly to bash the wires back into place and stop the sharks nibbling at the giant cable underneath the Atlantic.
Currently, at front is the Bulldog CQR Jaguar. Unfortunately, not in contention due to the mechanical issues that Magitap had just as we headed into the night stints.
It's a shame that car's run really well, apart from that one stint. I think it really could have challenged Black Sheep Race and the M&M Lamborghini.
I think overall the CQR car was the car to beat. Just they've done the best that they could, but they're not managed. No, the other teams have not had the problems that they had, so the stints and stuff like that haven't gone their way.
Essence of endurance racing: you may have the fastest car, but it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to win the race.
PG Hensley is in the cockpit for the PG Ferrari, or the Vodafone Ferrari, running just behind Drake Hillspawn, maybe just keeping his distance as well, just in case there is still any problems kicking about. So yeah, all the teams now, just like Le Mans, trying to bring it home in one piece anyway. Won't quite, well, unless the two CQR cars have finished their battle. I don't know if we'll see a CQR parade across the finish line like we did at Le Mans. Everyone's talking on the chat about discussing the 8 hours of Nürburgring. That's going to be towards the end of this year. will be December the 8th, I believe we've set the date for. As we discussed, the 8 hours of Nürburgring will be open to teams of 4 people, but you can realistically do that with a team of 2. You could even do 8 hours on your own if you really wanted to. That is possible. 8 hours of Nürburgring will take place on the weekend of the 8th and 9th of December, so expect to hear more details about that coming soon. There will be 3 classes of cars. A little bit of a shake-up, maybe quite a bit different from what we have in the Brit car just now. Cars will be more light Le Mans. You will see the GT cars making an appearance. They will be slightly adjusted to make them feel more light than Nürburgring. As you know, there's quite a lot of cars that we are running in the GT series that don't run at the Nürburgring. We're going to try and replicate it as close as possible.
I'm very hopeful that there'll be a strong field turning up for that one. Also, in the Nürburgring, it's a pretty cult following. But then Britcar is the same for this country, I suppose. I mean, it's certainly the only twice around the clock race that takes place in the UK. And I think in its short history, it's picked up quite a following online. I think it's fair to say that the number of participants that we've got for this race that isn't from the UK is testament to the fact that Britcar is obviously hopefully a known event around the world, or if not, hopefully we've done something to broaden the sports car endurance racing calendar for some of the people. It'd be interesting to see on the chat bag whether any of you guys had actually heard of Britcar before. As we just switched to the 007 being driven by Dan now for the final time of this race.
Yeah, Dan has been doing double duty. He's been running the Rogue Motorsports guest car in Lobby C.
Has he? Well, somebody has.
Just still struggling to get past the 1,000-mile mark.
Possibly falls slightly short of that. But, as I said earlier yesterday, a fantastic field for this race, and hopefully the Nürburgring 8-hour race in December will see another fantastic entry for that one, and hopefully a lot of return visitors. Bit early to say what the plans are for the Endurance Championship, the guaranteed turn to all the ones that each year. In terms of, a lot of effort goes in behind the scenes to get these events organised for everybody, and a little bit of downtime is nice from time to time.
Anyone on the chat back on the live stream can hear us, just let us know. We are having a lot of, as of we've been discussing all morning, we've been having a lot of technical difficulties with the speech. I think the stream seems to be fine, nice and clear, nice and smooth, but we are losing comms on and out.
I'm assuming you guys can still hear me.
Yeah, I can still hear you, just that last, you were just kind of breaking up a lot, that last stint.
I think Skype knows when I'm saying something uninteresting.
Yeah, Adrian has left us just now, he's away to clean up his microphone, try again in a little while.
If you stop eating around it, it'll probably be less problem. Hopefully he's just coming back. Is Duncan still with us?
Duncan is with us, but he said he'd be right back, so... He's without us right now.
There we go. He's nipped off to the smoking dog. Of course, the interesting thing for next weekend, this is just... The reason why I keep bringing this up is obviously to, you know, bring us into line with our real racing activities as well. Next weekend, you'll probably be able to hear, hopefully, you'll be able to hear from us and indeed see us on the live stream next weekend. And that will be coming. So I'm just interested in watching the Volcaro Lamborghini come around left field there. Gotta love that car. Sounds better when it's coming to Pasha, I'll tell you that for now. So next weekend we will be obviously commentating from the comfort of our own homes. There'll be bits and bobs going on that you'll be able to listen to and hopefully see on the live stream. That will be coming live from Garage 4A and B at the Britcar Circuit. With the official commentary team coming from Radio Le Mans, that will be from the commentary booths, well, wherever they are now, I guess.
Hopefully we'll be able to have a little word with Radio Le Mans at some point. It could be good to chat and meet up with them again. Currently watching the OCR car, Lamborghini, running around. Not too fast pace, running in sixth, bottom of the GTs in this lobby. Looks like he's got a little bit of damage on the front. But no actual damage to the car, so it's just cosmetic. As the OCR car, as we are watching him, goes straight on, coming out of Maggots and Beckett's, going onto the hangar straight. And I don't think that was lag. I think that was a misjudgment through the corner.
Probably been on for a long time and forgot that chap or corner was there.
Just noticed the sound of the cars. I think a lot of people mentioned this earlier on, the sound of the cars was very quiet for the morning, so I've now put that up a little bit. Currently in production GT, F4H Mopar trying to limit the damage in the F4H car, running around in that very well prepared Acura or whatever it's called.
It's Acura.
Acura. Acura sounds better.
Yeah, if you're Japanese.
The car unfortunately had a few problems with damage, and I think it had a lag out, didn't it, at some point?
It did. It dropped out very early in the race. I think it was stint 3, maybe?
Currently the production GT battle was heating up a lot from C Lobby. They were leading overall going into early hours of this morning, but we've not had any updates since then. As we've said, we would like to get these as soon as possible so that we can post them and make sure we've got everything covered.
Because it is currently distorting the results for this car, the Forza Racing Hungary car should be in second, behind the number 9 Hailfire Turner BMW, which is running obviously as well as its teammate. I'm going to twist it's missing this. Oh, that British Gamers car just had to bail out on the braking area of Abbey. It's off on the gravel. Almost forgot to brake and nearly took the rear off of that Cayman.
So
we certainly don't need any
car. It just seems to go straight off. I don't think there's any damage given to that Ferrari. No damage on the back of that Cayman either.
Look, like he took evasive quite well, so...
As we see the CQRS Golf with its for sale sign on the new door. I don't know if that is that the door that's for sale or is it the car that's for sale?
it's gonna be the car. No doubt.
It'll be one of these eBay specials whereby congratulations, you are bidding for a photo of a
just saw on the driver tracker, two cars looked like they were very close to each other. The Porsche and the BG Vodafone car are coming together, going through Maggots and Beckett's. Not 100% sure what happened there.
Another one.
Damage on front of BJ Hensey and damage to the rear of the Forza Racing Hungary car, so let you make up your own minds about what exactly happened there. Not too much damage on the BG car. 26% front aero, make it very slidey going through the corners. Bit of damage on the side door as well though, so I don't know if that's...
It wouldn't be a an endurance race where you're making contact with a member of VG. So normally it is an Audi.
And there are none of them taking part in this race.
No, but it is part of the same umbrella group, isn't it? So it kind of like it's obviously transferable.
What is unluckiness?
One would assume. But I mean, that actually seemed quite nice, because we haven't really seen a lot of that.
As we go back on the BMW, it is lagging severely again, so problems again rearing their head. Yeah. Lag, as everybody is saying on the chat.
Jazz hands. I'm not going to carry what I was saying, I've forgotten entirely. No, that's what I was saying. Yeah, one thing we haven't really seen much of this race is contact between other car. Well, car. Different groups in. That's very good, I think, and certainly I have a couple of close calls, but we've got the wherewithal to stay out of it. I know we saw the crash for the CQR earlier on at Bridge. That's obviously set. Be sacked for that. What's it going now?
As the CQR Jag takes another lap out of the fight for her Acura.
Currently, with this being the last stint, obviously it is a longer race, full two-hour stint to end on. We will be going slightly over the 2 hour, the 2 o'clock time again. Just slight delay to A lobby as we were going through this.
Just very briefly in other news, for those of a sideways disposition, it is Wales Rally B this weekend, and Petter Solberg has taken second place from Sebastian Loeb by 3/10 of a second. I don't know what surprises me more, the fact that Solberg is quicker than Loeb, or the fact Loeb isn't in first place.
I don't think it's surprising that Loeb isn't in first place. It's surprising that he's still in the WRC, to be honest with you.
It's surprising the WRC is still in the WRC, to be honest with you.
Yeah, there is that. And thanks once again to Christian Rose, who's now going to focus his efforts on supporting the CQRish car as it comes to the line to take a check the flag. Thanks for taking part in tonight's and... In fact, the 24-hour commentary throughout. And we'll see you on the other side of the checkered flag. So back with a fight for her Black Sheep Ford GT.
Currently running his own race, just keeping himself out of trouble. All he needs to do is make sure the car finishes this stint, and he's won the overall positions, just like they did at Le Mans with the LMP car.
They also won one of these cars in GTE spec, but I believe it wasn't on the ball. It was doing laps, but it wasn't even close to the top three.
No, the Ford GT at Le Mans had major problems towards the start and spent a lot of time in the garage. As they said, they were really, really annoyed with that, and they've been working very hard to make sure that the cars are going to stay strong and stay stable throughout the stint, or throughout the full race rather than just a stint.
So they've taken the car from Le Mans, given it a bit of a shake, cleaned out the dust, put a new lick of paint on it, and boom, it's almost won the brick car 4 hours.
I think F4H was out here to make a point this time around. They were pretty determined to show that they were the best team on Forza Motorsport 4, or one of the best teams on Forza Motorsport 4. As we have all seen, CQR would have been a very close contender for them if it wasn't for Magic Tab having these issues.
Well, Fighter have made a point already. They did win long overall, and they did did a decent job in the other car they were running in GTE, one of the Chevrolet ZR1s. This is CQR just putting another lap down on the Talbot of British Gamers. And that is now chasing down a possible top 10 finish overall. I was going to give you an update, but we still don't have an important number from Lobby C for the last two stints.
Still awaiting them. The last stint is running just now, so not too worried that there won't be a problem. We'll get them. Not worried about that.
The only problem they are causing is the determination of the outcome of the production GT class. Hailfire's number 9 was leading that class. It's going to be hard to decide what to do if we don't get them at all, but let's hope that doesn't come to be.
I'm sure they'll get them. I'm sure we'll get them. I'm sure they would have wrote them down, and even if they weren't able to get them straight to us, they'll obviously be keeping check on them. If they haven't given them to us at all, we won't be able to score the stint. Simple as. I know the stint ran, and unless all the drivers remember their distances and can PM me the distance, then we won't be able to score it until we know the kind of distances that they were doing.
So there is the potential for the Forza Racing Hungary car to win this via a complete F up in admin.
It could. I mean, it's
let's hope it doesn't come down to that. Still looking at Haburi, and we're going to switch away now to FOH. Well, we were FOH, but as ATR Dan and the Jaguar, massive hats off to them for the recovery from the early crashes in stints 1 and 2. Eventual podium finish for ATR Dan, who's been metronomic not only in this car but also the Rogue Guest car that's still circulating at the back of the park, and should be looking at more than 1,000 miles completed and more than 350 laps.
That's a good target for them to aim for, seeing as they had so just a little amount of drivers for this race.
Almost like its real life counterpart at last year's Britcar, because that car was constantly in the pits, and I would say the finish before I was to go.
I believe they had some driver. They were possibly had some driver issues this year with their car, but I think they've resolved that. So fortunately, they're not in the position, same position as their virtual car. that's currently running around. It's a pity that's not in, it's a pity that we can't switch between lobbies on the fly, and it's also a pity that we couldn't get every single competitor in the same lobby. Maybe at some point in the future, if we do that, when we're doing this later on different games or different consoles. But just now we have to make do with what we have, and currently we have up to 12 cars in each lobby competing for the full 24 hours. And as we have seen, lobby C and lobby B have been very competitive with lobby A, so it's been very close all night long.
The Aston Martin is now going to get past. He's just decided to strike out all the cones on the exit of Brooklands. Has let through the Ford GT. There it goes.
Currently in Clubman, BG Smithy running around at the back just now with the Dodge. As we noticed earlier on, in the stint, the stickers have fallen off the sides of the car, must have peeled off in the wind, so unfortunately they won't have their sponsor seeing them, they won't be able to see their sponsor as they cross the line for what is quite a very high position in the clubman class.
It's the Teflon Talbot.
A little bit slidey through the corners as well, so either tiredness getting to them, or just having a little bit of fun on the track as they circulate. As we saw in the last stint, Defcon Luke managed to jump the two CQR cars who battled all race long, jumped them in the pits, and has given them a little bit of overall distance on them. Unfortunately, all ended on the same total mileage, and we can't see the points or the decimal places on mileage in this game. But if that had been for the ISCC style finish that we're doing in this one, that would have been very, very important. Currently in the lead of...
Literally then, 1 hour to go.
Yes.
Yep.
Well, 1 hour 50.
Oh, spoil sport.
It's been a long day.
It has.
Currently in the lead of the clubman class is the CQR Civic with that wing,
which has been slowing it down ever since.
I don't think anyone's given it enough of a bash in the back to get the wing off. Currently the bonnet looks like it's coming up a little bit, so hopefully that doesn't flip up and hit the windscreen or block the driver's view.
That'll wake him up. There's some pretty serious, interesting bodywork alterations going on the front of that car.
Also looks like the whole back of the car has been crumpled in as well.
No, that's just how it was designed.
Paper mache bumpers.
No, it's just designed to look like a smashed buttock.
Anyway. I'm looking from the live time and looking at the car list and the restrictions I put on certain cars. Most notably the Aston Martin V12 Vantage and GT production is the only car that had a 15% air intake reduction to keep it on par with the rest of the field, and it's kept that formula looking quite neat and tidy. Nobody's really dominated that class. There were complaints that the Aston was too quick, and despite it being third potentially overall come the 24th hour, that was down to hard work. I hope that's just down to hard work as well. My hand was driving that car,
so I think it's fair to say it's not been an easy ride for Aston Martin Racing in this event. They had the 004 car leading the class in the early stages before some issues in the pits caused them to be heavily delayed. The 007 was off to a good start as well, and that car in the hands of Dan Austin's had two sizable accidents in the first and second stint. Obviously restricted the amount of distance that he could run, and really it was the first stint that pegged back the car significantly. Otherwise, you know, we could be looking at for any. But you know, the guys have done fantastic work, and the car is looking strong now. It's worth fighting with the Civic. I think he's just gotten to the Civic actually going down the straight. And he'll be looking forward to taking the checkered flag run. Hopefully, if all things being. Hopefully, he'll have to stop.
Just a quick update, we finally got stint 10, we're all still awaiting stint 11 from C-Lobby, but stint 10 has now been updated on the live timing, so the Hailfire car, the number 9, put in a stint of 168, so that is keeping it right up there. That would have still been in the lead going into the 11th stint then.
We've only got four numbers down in stint 10.
I've refreshed.
Oh, right, okay.
Just refreshed. As Blizzard points out, MotoGP start has been delayed. That's because we are still continuing to race. Obviously, they're all watching what we're doing. It's a lot more interesting than the MotoGP.
I desperately want to disagree with you, but it's so oh dear, the halcyon days of MotoGP are long since departed. Sadly, World Superbike is where it's at. Well, they are going around Misano this weekend, which is quite a circuit. It's actually been renamed. This is Simmons, been named after Marcus Vincelli. Good track. Yes, Blackbird, you are right. British Superbikes is better than both. Unfortunately, I couldn't actually take the lead in that though, because I've actually seen any races this year. I'm assuming Tommy Hill's probably doing quite well in it, and Shaky. Shaky Burns still in it? I'd assume yes.
Okay, just a little update on the overall standings for Stint C. Hailfire recorded himself and his teammates, which is one of the cars we're very interested in. That is the HR Turner number 9 car. So going into this stint, HR Turner had 1,832 miles. Forza Racing Hungary car had 1,821, so the HR Turner car is still in the lead by about 9 miles in total. So a couple of laps gap. Obviously this race, this stint, the Forza Racing Hungary car has had a bit of a collision with the BG car. That won't be helping its case, so we will be awaiting for the final stint results and the remaining results of stint 11 for Lobby C.
believe we're missing one car from Lifetime in Lobby C then. No, we're not. No, we're not missing it. It's a big line now. I completely missed it. Not to worry.
We see the FRH car back on track with the CQR car bearing down on it. Still running with a little bit of damage, so that will be hindering it as it goes through. Very close from the Jag, that was extremely close going through bridge.
So after the 20th hour of racing, the Clean Races Association Sierra is still in third place in class on the turn of the morning.
Watching the Hillfire car in the top class, Drake Hillspawn at the wheel, lag seems to still be affecting him, but he's pretty much out there on his own, so currently had no reports of any problems from the lag. He's not been anywhere near any other cars and not caused any issues, so no black flags and no problems going for him.
Without stint 11 from Lobby C, I can only sort of project that the Turner, Hellfire Turner BMW, is going to win the GP race by a projected 16 miles or 4 laps ahead of the Photo Racing Hungary car. And the Black Sheep car will have won the race overall by a projected 8 miles.
As you can see on the side of that Golf, they saved the ring logo. Currently for the Nürburgring issues and the financial problems that's going through, the M&M car is also running a Save the Ring logo, as we was brought to attention on the Save the Ring Facebook page earlier on yesterday. Quite a lot of support for our race, just and everyone's shown their support for the Save the Ring and for the Nürburgring that's in major financial troubles just now. And as discussion, or as we've been discussing throughout the event, the Nürburgring 8 Hours, which is our last event of the year, the way we will be saying goodbye to 2012 with that, we will be racing in teams of up to 4, can be between 2 and 4 drivers in a car for the 8 Hours day or race in Nürburgring. Same stint format as what we're doing just now, it'll be 1 hour 45 around the ring, and then the last stint will be a full 2 hours just like we've been doing just now. We are currently at the 1 hour mark to go before we finish what has been an incredible 24 hour race. didn't expect the support and didn't expect the numbers we were going to get, especially not for the Silverstone version of this endurance race. Originally the Silverstone version was only going to be a 12 hour race as well, until we were kind of peer pressured into doing 24 hours a couple of months ago.
Well, I think the popularity soared once the 24 hours of Le Mans had taken place, and I think just this was perfect time to get another one in.
Yeah, four throughout the year is plenty for us, especially with the amount of time and effort we've had to put into it, and just the fact that all the planning we've had to go into and all the promotion and everything like that. It's taken its time, and we'll be going straight on to the Nürburgring lead up after this this month actually, because we'll be in Silverstone next weekend for the real Britcar 24 hours.
Hopefully not doing the exact same thing over and over again.
No, there will be a lot of interesting features and interviews and photographic opportunities and all this, that and the other, plus everything else that's going on in the garage. For all the details, please check out the website and the Britcar special podcast, which is also available in the TORA radio section. Plenty of news there. And if you're able to get down to the circuit next weekend, we will be there from Friday all the way through to the conclusion of the race on Sunday afternoon.
I'm back.
Hello.
Duncan Ray.
Duncan has joined us for the final hour of coverage from the TORA Britcar for our race. Duncan, as we have seen, we are still waiting Lobby C's 11. XBR Donut is currently hosting the final stint, and he hosted both 11 and 12. He has got all of the scores, but he didn't want to delay the start times for taking them down and sending them over so he could get the lobbies going as soon as possible. So,
okay.
Huge, really thankful effort to the XBR guys. They've just brought themselves forward and, you know, sort of our last sort of very late minute attempt to get some lobby hosts for Lobby C. We were sort of expecting to have staff in all lobbies, but the way qualifying works, we never know quite how it's going to happen.
Yeah.
We are very thankful to XBR.
Actually, I'm thankful to all the hosts, actually. They've done a fantastic job getting everybody in and out. And all the drivers. I think all the drivers are showing quite a lot of respect across the traffic management as well. So thanks to everyone.
It's been very impressive. There's not been any traffic or major traffic problems. I know that we're only running with 12 cars in the lobby, so there is more GT cars, obviously, than the rest of them. 3 production GT cars and 3 clubman cars in each class. I'm pretty sure that if there was 9 clubman cars, like the full field of clubman cars, the full field of production GT cars, and the full field of the TORA GT cars, it'd be a lot more hectic.
People there, yeah.
Yeah, it'd be a lot more difficult. And as we're saying, hopefully someday we'll be able to see that on the console. But as we make the best of what we can, and Forza provides us what the best game to run what we want to do from.
Me and Richie could just play this in R Factor 2 next year, but there'd be 2 of us.
Me and you for the 24 hours.
Yeah. Oh dear. How long we got left in stint A? Sorry, left stint lobby A.
Just under an hour left.
Just
under
an hour.
XBR Essex Boy, the race finishes at 2 hours. So they go for the counters up to 2 hours and 15, but they race for the full 2 hours. And if you've ever taken part in our ISCC races, it ends with the drivers finish the lap they're on. They don't stop on the track like they have been doing at every other stint, and once they finish the lap they're on, they take the distance recorded and the time that they crossed the line at, and it's all evened out and balanced up.
Well, Right then, so what's going on with Lobby A? Are we just waiting for Lobby C to find out if it's going to have any effect on overall positions?
Lobby C, the HR Turner car,
yeah,
the number 9 car, is currently leading Production GT by 11 miles, I believe, going into this stint. They are racing the Forza Racing Hungary car, which has had a collision with the BG Vodafone car. As you'll see in a moment, they have also just come out of the pits as well. As Hellfire is noting, their BMWs have been known to roll quite easily, so anything could happen in this last stint, as we saw at Sebring.
Yeah.
The whole GT field was turned on its head in the last 2 hours. So, eyes peeled, F4H Mopar currently leading this race and keeping the F4H car up in front. He is running his own race, his own pace, in third position just now. He's just making sure he brings the car home in one piece, not going for flat out, just letting cars have their own lines and just doing his own thing. As I said earlier on, unfortunately there won't be any other F4H, except for the Production GT car. We won't have a 3 car flying finish like we had at Le Mans at the end of the stint.
Yeah. But Rishi, how would you say, as head of the endurance series, this weekend's gone quite so far?
The endurance series, how it's went so far?
Yeah, well, this meeting with Britcar.
This meeting's been incredible. It's we didn't expect the numbers, didn't expect the amount of teams and drivers, and the amount of people that's been interested in the sort of Britcar aspect of it all. It's different from Le Mans, it's different types of cars, it's maybe not something that you would expect for a full endurance race, especially a lot of clubman cars running around. Everyone's put in such a huge effort and there's not been any big delays or anything, we're only about 10 minutes behind at most. It's been great, really, really thankful for everybody that took part. Obviously, as we've said it in the past, we wouldn't be here if you guys weren't racing here. The endurance races have certainly become the sort of crown in our, you know, our kind of rota and stuff like that now. It's been very humbling to have this many people and have this many people saying such great things about it. Obviously, don't forget, we have got our normal series running every Sunday, and the touring cars will be making a return in very early 2013 as we look to fill up our Tuesday nights again.
Yeah.
Currently, our Tuesday nights are getting run in a kind of mini-series fashion. How is his Porsche Super Cup getting on, Duncan?
That's really good. First race is a bit interesting around Silverstone International. In both lobbies, I think the AM class had a bit of a better race, but the last meeting at Sebring, I think both lobbies, Pro and AM, had a really good race. We're off to Suzuka next this Tuesday. Sign ups are open. Depending on who signs up, I was automatically putting people into AM using the slower Porsche 911 Cup car, while the pro drivers are in the most recent Black Swan Racing GT 3 Cup car. But I think the cars have worked really well. I think the AM car is actually my favourite car to drive. I think the power to weight ratio in that car is fantastic. Plus, it's the old school dash in there as well, because it's still got the analog dash with the digital readout on the right hand side. It does feel like you're in a proper old school Porsche Cup car. So I really, really do like it.
The AM cars, I like the AM car.
A lot of people ask, you know, what's the plan for after the Porsches?
Well, it's very interesting, actually. We've been discussing this with Plough Tubby. I'm pretty sure he'll be happy for us to discuss this just now. The Plough guys have been looking at running a compact cup style series, so basically junior touring cars.
Yeah.
Smaller cars, less power, all that kind of good stuff. That will be happening after the Porsche Super Cup on Tuesday night. Details will go up this week before we head down to Britcar, hopefully. Small tracks, I think we're still discussing tracks, what we're going to do. Just expect to see cars. You're going to obviously know what's you're going to expect. What would you expect from a compact cup? We're going to have like the Yaris, the Abarth, Signet, Citroen C1s, the Ford Ka, the Nissan Micra. It's going to be very interesting.
Yeah. So that should be quite good fun. I mean, it'll be interesting for the. I mean, when we've run the Abarth in the past and stuff, and Forza 2, Forza 3, and Forza 3 and 4. It'll be always quite good fun, so it'll be interesting to see how them little cars will be going. Will the tracks be the same size as the car, so we're going to be around like Iberium and things like that?
Yeah, I think we'll make them smaller tracks. There's no point in running these kind of little slow cars around Sebring full or something like that.
Yeah.
More, as we said, more information will come out as we move, well, as we go into the end. After, obviously, we're trying to fill up the Tuesday nights with kind of with series that are small, compact, and people that can just enjoy them for a little while. We are looking at bringing the classic Trans Am back.
Mm-hmm.
That was a fantastic series when we did it for the National Motorsport Week.
Yeah,
a lot of people really enjoyed that. That was very off the cuff, very quickly made car list, and it seemed to work really well. So we'll be definitely looking at bringing that back around some classic American racetracks as well.
Definitely, that was good fun. Is that going to suit us down towards the end of the year as we get the
That should take us pretty much up to the end. I mean, this is by the time the Junior Cup starts, that'll sort of fill up October. Then November will be looks like it'll probably be filled by the Trans Am racing, and then December we may have a little break as we go get ready to start the touring cars in probably January 2013. Touring cars will be going through a very slight change. I know there was a lot of talk last season about how close the cars were. We don't want to mess up that. The cars were fantastic. They had some of the best racing we've ever seen. A lot of the guys, the tuners and all that, said that the cars were very close and very well put together. But we would like to try and include rear wheel drive in some shape or form.
Yeah.
So we are looking into that just now. We may be increasing the horsepower limit to up one kind of bracket. Slight change in PI, slight change in the way that the cars are built, but hopefully we should still see the same classic TORA touring cars that you normally see.
Yeah, it's not going to be drastic. I mean, it's going to bring the hopefully bring some real world drive back, but still keep the options very very close and compact to the build rules, so we don't get a variety in the speed of the cars. But I think the last season's touring cars were fantastic. I couldn't really make much of the season, but I think we want to run a smaller season, don't we, and split them up for the year. I think that'd be
smaller season. I think the 12 meeting epic that we had for the touring cars started to drag on a little bit towards the end. Everyone still turned up, we still had very high numbers of drivers all the time, everyone still really enjoyed it, but it was a little bit long for us for organisation wise. And
I suppose enjoyment factor for certain members who aren't at the front end of the field as well did drop off. I did hear that comment because of the longevity of the series. So I think two shorter series maybe may work just as well for the touring cars.
I mean shorter series for the touring cars was sort of good. I mean, I know we're having a long series for the GTs this season. We'll wait and see. We'll review at the end of the season how well that's worked and if people have enjoyed the length of the series.
Yeah, I think Simon's got some big plans for that series next year.
Yeah, some possibly big changes for the cars. Keep expecting them to be just as close as they are now. As we've seen at Silverstone, the TORA GT cars have proven to be very closely matched.
Yeah, definitely.
It's all down to the drivers now, and especially and also the way the cars are tuned.
Mm.
We've seen drivers going on very fast laps in the cars that their teammates are running, and then their teammates are getting in the car and running quite a bit slower. So very, very, very even.
Definitely.
This track's really shown it, I think.
Should we go for a rundown of positions in Lobby A? Because we haven't talked about the race for a good 15 minutes.
Well, 45 minutes left to go on the clock as we head into the last, well, this is the last part of the incredible race that we've had this weekend. CQR, Haburi currently leading the way in the Jaguar. That Jaguar has been very quick and very consistent, and would have been certainly would have been a race winning or potential race winning car. But unfortunately, because of Magic Tap's technical steering issues early on in the night, the car had to be wheeled into the garage for extensive repairs, which took about 2 hours to do. Yep. Car came back out onto the track during the mid-break pit stop sort of thing, and has been just pounding the laps in ever since. CQR Chris, shout out to him. He did a full 8 hour back-to-back stint in this car to cover Magic Tap's unfortunate.
That's quite impressive. Yes, that's going to be nuts. That's ridiculous.
Unbelievable. This car we were expecting to do very well. Obviously, it shows you how much work they've put into the Jaguar for the GT series. Drake Hillspawn in the Hellfire Turner car, currently battling with M&M Racing, is now in the pits. They were only 1 mile behind, I believe, or 1 or 2 miles behind the M&M car as we went into this stint. M&M cars a couple of thousand feet behind on this race, just keeping check of them. So Drake is sitting third. F4H Face Palmer in the Jag, keeping it clean, keeping out of trouble, trying to bring the car home for that elusive GT win in the TORA Endurance Racing Series. Currently sitting now second overall in the lobby. Ian MR in the Lamborghini, just not too far behind Drake Hellspawn as he comes out the pits. A little bit of damage on the rear of the car with some earlier contact with the fellow Lamborghini that's racing in for the OCR team, running the race winning paint from Sebring and what has been running the GT series just now. BJ Hainsey is in 5th position overall, had a bit of a hefty bit of contact with the Forza Racing Hungary car about 10-15 minutes into the stint, I believe. That car had showed huge potential, especially at the hands of BG Crunk, but their fastest driver did lag out right at the start of a stint. That put them on the back foot and sort of battling out with CQR as they go.
That lag out was caused on the 5th stint. It was the same stint as the massive pile up on pit straight in the early out minutes of the stint. Hainsey, Crunk got off cleanly, I think, in that stint, but completely lagged out due to a separate issue. Only about 37 miles in that stint.
Nearly forgot about that. We did have a massive crash in that stint on the start finish straight. There was a bit of lag involved and the F4H car spun out of control, causing the Hellfire Turner car to run straight into the back of it. It was up in the air. Huge crash. It was just about as bad as ATR Dan's car. Fortunately, both cars were able to get back to the pits and get repairs made.
Definitely. I think, how did they make it the time? Was it the next couple of stints they put, the night stints they put the times in?
Sorry, Duncan, what was that?
After that initial huge incident, I can't remember what stint was that. Was that they're going towards stints?
That was stint 5, so that was five. Going into, that was at midnight that stint ended, so that was going into the early hours of the morning. Okay. Cars recovered well. The Turner car is still going very well. The Black Sheep F4H car, they've been running pretty much consistent. 176, 178, 175, 178, and then they had their collision at stint 5, which brought them down to 171. Let the other teams catch up with them quite a lot. But then they continued their pace of 177, 176 all the way through to the end, where Bullet has put in two back-to-back stints of 178. Definitely the team and definitely the car to beat this time around.
Definitely. That's very impressive mileage on that car throughout the night. Just looking to see what happened to my team. Rogue Motorsports BMW with M3 GTR. Let's have a look.
So currently 8th overall.
Yeah.
After, well, I've projected the mileage to be potentially 2,054 miles come the end of the race. Currently sitting on 1,857 after 11.
Okay. I see it was just the issue Rice had in stint
5. That was you, wasn't it?
No, that was Rice.
Right, okay. Yeah, average of 175 miles, except for the 102 miles did where there was a lag, I'm guessing.
Yeah, I think he must have lagged out of a connection issue.
as everyone is discussing, this is a 15-minute longer stint, so we will see lap records where the laps at the distance maximum extended quite a bit, with some people looking at about 200 laps in the 2-hour stint.
Miles.
200 miles, yes.
200 laps.
200 laps of Silverstone National.
We're not in a... I don't think.
We still haven't had an update on the old man gamer car, the SRN Motorsports MX5 for stint number 7. There's no number there at all, so it's either not, I've repeated this earlier, it's either not been put down, or there's not got time at that. Either way, we need to find out.
Yeah, if anyone in SRN Motorsports is currently listening or running or whatever in B Lobby, stint 7, their distance is completely missing. We do not have a number for it, unfortunately. The all other numbers have been taken down. It's been completely missed out, so we don't know if it's just been a simple mistake and been overlooked, or if they did 0 miles and it wasn't recorded.
And I think that was Duncan explaining again, as he was early on in the stint, in the race. Now looking at ATR Dan's Aston Martin.
No.
Hey! Now looking at cool G84's Porsche Cayman, still potentially second in GT production.
Yeah, Forza Racing Hungary with their debut Forza TORA race, I think. I'm not sure if they've been racing in any of our series. And if this is their debut, it's almost as fantastic as the A1X teams. Their big debut was Le Mans. So the endurance race is definitely bringing some new teams to the grid for the challenge for the wins, and to come and get a second place, their first race with us, is pretty incredible. As everyone's noticing, the B Lobby car of Flawed Fish is the current third placed car in the TORA GT. That is another car that we can't see, unfortunately, and we have to wait until the end of the stint for an update. Just like how we have the HR Turner car number 9 in C Lobby, and we can't get a live update of it until the race is finished.
Hate to correct you there, Ian, but you did say third for Flawed Fish. They're actually fourth, because the M&M Racing car is in second place, the Hailfire 2 in the car.
No, the Flawed Fish car is in front of the Hailfire car by 1 mile. I'll republish. So if you refresh, you should be able to see it.
Where's Simon gone? I haven't seen Simon online for ages.
Well, Simon did the night shift.
Night stint, so
he did pretty much all night, so he's having a very well deserved break. Currently leading Clubman CQR in the Civic with that wing. Currently on 123 miles, looking to extend the advantage it has over its fellow CQR car, the CQR-ish Golf. Currently running in second in this lobby, however, is BG Smithy in the Dodge with the massive team radio antenna they've got on the front of the car. We all know how bad the signal is around Silverstone. Currently asking if the CQR Golf has pitted or if he's got damage. Looks like he's probably pitted. Currently only got 1.9% on the back, 3.1% on the front, so yeah, he's not long out the pits. currently watching the CQ Irish Golf as we go into the final minutes of the 24-hour race around Silverstone. This is the TORA Britcar event, with the real Britcar event happening next weekend at the actual track. CQR Haburi currently leads this lobby in the CQR Bulldogs car. However, it's not in contention for overall win, seeing as they had steering issues and technical problems throughout the early evening yesterday. Just hello to the chat back and all apparently 68 viewers that are watching us. It's good to see everybody supporting us throughout this race. It's been very, very incredible, and it's been very long for us. It feels a bit longer than Le Mans, to be honest. I don't know if it's just...
It's just a long... It's just because the circuit's a lot shorter, so it's a lot more intense when you're
done
this stint.
We weren't really prepared for Le Mans for the live style, and that came about extremely late. Very, very last minute. It was like, oh, we can actually do some live streaming, and we ended up doing it. And Adrian and I ended up doing far too much and did so much talking. I think we even went even further into the night and woke up even earlier in the morning for streaming because of we were just that excited for it. Mm-hmm. Took a little bit more sensible tonight or today with the Silverstone. We were off air from midnight until 8 a.m. I think Simon was doing some live streaming on board his car. But I need to watch that back. I've only seen a few. That says a few shows have been recorded, but I'm not 100% sure. It's been long though. It's only 22:12 UK time. We are about 10 to 15 minutes behind on a lobby. But not long now until
what
we see
the
checker flag.
The Nürburgring race. We talked about that.
Nürburgring race. I was thinking we start it at about 2 as well and finish at 10 at night. Unless you want to start a little bit later and go till like sort of midnight time.
Yeah, that's pretty good. That's a good time, isn't it?
I think the two p.m. start's been quite good for us. It'll be on the Saturday as well because obviously we don't want everyone staying up late on Sunday night because it's a school night.
Yeah.
So Saturday, the 8th of December, we'll be doing the same sort of package to qualifying for the race because of the way the Nürburgring is. It'll be long laps, a lot of concentration. The usual rules for us when we're qualifying is laps have to be clean. Around the Nürburgring, that is extremely difficult. So we'll need to have a wee discussion about that, I think. What do you think, Duncan? You think it should be clean every lap?
Yeah, it should be clean.
Clean laps, qualifying, which is going to make it very intense. Teams of between 2 and 4 drivers, so you could have... We could potentially have 2 drivers doing the full like 4 hours each. You could even have 1 driver doing the 8 hours if you're crazy enough.
Yeah, I'm thinking about doing it.
What's quite good about the fact that we're doing that though is the numbers just now, they are all spread out like 3 or 4 drivers in each team.
Yeah.
Hopefully if people go down to two drivers per team or 3 or 4 or whatever, we'll have more people taking part. And the Nürburgring is a well known endurance race.
Yes.
Britcar's not particularly well known, and it's a very oddball choice for us to race around Silverstone 24 hours on Forza. So
interesting, we can get some more European teams, like the Hungarian team and
It'll be good to, we'll do a little bit of promo for the actual Nürburgring, for the Nürburgring team, seeing as we're doing a sort of virtual one. The Carlos will be going through a slight shake up because we want to have the cars a bit more relevant to the actual Nürburgring class, so there's a lot of TORA GT cars that don't appear at the Nürburgring, so they may be getting cut. We'll be discussing that as we go on. The all-wheel drive class will be making a return for the sort of alternate powertrain, as we've seen the 2 years ago. I think the Golf what's the Golf GTIs?
Oh, it was the
Golf R's. They were their four-wheel drive big.
Yeah, and also you had the Scirocco all-wheel drive, didn't you? The gas-powered.
It's
And then also the all-wheel drive. The all-wheel drive Mini, was that last year or this year?
I'm not sure. I mean, I know that the Scirocco R, we used that as four-wheel drive last year. Yeah. It is an alternate powertrain car, so we will probably use that as four-wheel drive again for this year's one. the likes of the TTRS, we probably not have production GT in the race.
Mm. Yeah, but so you might have. I was thinking, you've got two choices, don't we? You've got the new touring car class we could bring in, but then you got a lot of the old like the BMW 1 Series you want to put one in with like stock aero. There's a number of cars we could look at as well, so we'll have a think about it anyway. So
yeah, we'll be having a look because we don't want to go over three classes. We've seen how much we've struggled with three classes this time around.
Yeah.
And we tried three classes. We had three classes at Sebring, LMP1, LMPC, and the LMP2 cars. I was concentrating on something else there. We had LMP1, LMPC and GT. That was our three Sebring classes. LMPC was very low numbers. So for thank you Mark for correcting me. The Le Mans we tried to do LMP1, LMP2 and GT. Unfortunately LMP2 had I think one person sign up for it. So we cut that down to the two classes, and that worked very well for Le Mans, I have to say, LMP versus GT. Then for the Silverstone 24 hours of the Britcar race, we wanted to have three classes. Clubman is quite obvious, that's very Clubman level as the Britcar. GT cars are the sort of highest spec GT3 style cars that we run in the TORA GT. That is sort of the highest cars for
Britcar, yeah. But you're saying that, they do run, they've got some prototype-ish Clubman class cars running in a real Britcar.
Yeah, I mean it would be great to have like the Radicals and stuff like that racing around here as their own little class, but three classes is sort of I think the maximum because we struggled with Clubman.
Yeah.
Don't know if it was the build rules for Clubman, and we've seen some of the best racing we've seen has been in the Clubman class so far. I think the whole Clubman Cups were very successful races, but I think people really wanted to go for the outright win this time around. TORA GT filled up instantly. You know, we hit that many cars, we'd had to put a cap onto it.
Definitely, I think the everyone was looking to go for their race. That filled up quite quickly, didn't it? Sorry, just experienced a few technical issues here. 1 second. Is Adrian on that? Can Adrian hear us?
I think we're having some more technical difficulties with our microphones in the commentary booth.
Yeah, but I'll be quite interested to see what they do for Forza 5 for next gen. I think this kind of event, if they make it how we expect them to make it, like having day to night time, more people in the lobby with a better technology there, better net connection, better net code, I think it would be 50 people going around the lobby. Richie, can you imagine that? 50, yeah, loads of classes. I think that'd be awesome.
That would be awesome. I don't think we could. I think Xbox Live could handle that many people just now.
Nah, they've upgraded completely Xbox Live, haven't they? Be interesting. The netcode needs completely resume. But it'd be interesting to see. See, now I was saying to Richie the other night, I still expect to see that on the 360.
Yeah, I think Forza 5 potentially could be on the 360. Just the way the
market's going at the moment, and the development of the next generation Xbox as well, and the problems in production at the moment with the processing chips at the moment. They're really short on the components. I'm hearing a lot of the industry, so it'll be interesting to see. We might, as we're seeing Microsoft next week, we'll, I don't know.
I don't think they'll tell us.
Lock you in the room and say, I'm not going to let you out until you tell us.
Obviously, Forza Horizon is the next step for the Forza franchise. I'm personally looking forward to just having a bit of fun on it. The day night cycle, we will be seeing that it's getting used and it will be possible, so I think we'd safely expect that to be in the next Forza Motorsport game.
You'd hope, wouldn't you? But then we never know. We might have a Gran Turismo 5 on our hands with Forza 5, so we don't know.
Well, maybe. Might use all the old car models from Forza 4 and not upgrade them or something like that.
Yeah, be interesting. But well, don't forget, next week at the Britcar, we've got the first UK demo of Horizon in the area where we'll be. So thanks to Microsoft for that.
Yep, there'll be 8 demo pods in the back of the Rogue Motorsport guys, just beside where we are, running the first UK demoing, public demo of Forza Horizon. And yes, CQR Basher, the TORA Gumball will be taking place. We'll be having big point-to-point races, possibly rallies, depends how the online system will work. And we don't know how well it'll be set out. It's all open world. I don't know if there'll be ribbons of cars that'll like track that you can race on, point to point style races like in Forza 5 and Forza 4 and stuff like that.
Yeah, the Forza Horizon and then the normal Forza Motorsport game will be alternating. We've already established that through the contacts we've got, so I'll be at Britcar for next year. I would if you want to see something spectacular.
The discussion of project cars, I've got project cars and can confirm that the day night cycle around the new Silverstone Arena track with very Britcar style cars is fantastic.
Yeah, definitely. That's one I can't wait to get. But I mean, there's so many games coming out as well over next year for us racing fans. You've got GTR3, still rumoured to be in production. You've got Simbin's free online racing game, which looks awesome. You've got project cars. You've got R Factor 2. Now, some of the mods already in development that look spectacular. So. But in cars, you know, cars are going to be out there 360 as well, so shoot, hopefully that'll be quite good for the guys who don't have access to our high power PC.
It'll be interesting. I mean, Shift 2 is out on the Xbox. Anyway, going back to the OCR Lamborghini, going through the first turn, really with BG Hensey. Trying to lap him, actually. Trying to put a lap on the OCR car.
Blue flag should be waving here.
Quite. May let him pass after the Maggots and Becketts. He's kind of going wide.
Aha! Have we been joined in the booth by Simon?
Oh,
he's on his medieval microphone.
Yeah, Simon's going back in time.
Am I? Okay, hold on a second.
Quick, Doc Brown. As we've approaching Callum, we've got left, Richard. I think we've got that long left now.
Got just over half an hour. Just over 50, 20 minutes left. Before
my
we
Laptop
finish,
can have a mind of its own sometimes and just chooses a microphone that I just never would ever want to use, so I don't know why I chose it.
How art thou, Simon?
Zombie.
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 Really? How was last night?
Oh, that is a dirty car, isn't it? Well done, Hellfire. You failed to buy cleaning products. Obviously.
They've cleaned the numbers.
I can see that at least they've cleared the numbers. At least they've cleared the numbers. I actually found, especially last night when I jumped into the car just after we went off air, this race I found a lot more enduring than Le Mans.
Yeah.
I've actually just woken up and I've still noticed that my right index finger, the accelerator pedal, has completely swollen up.
Yeah.
There's much more corners. It's so more tiring, and it got to, I think it even got to only halfway through my second stint, and that mixed in also with the tiredness. I really struggled,
really,
to get those laps in, but I continued on. I made sure that I didn't sort of hinder anyone else's race, because I was flying off the circuit numerous times, sheerly due to not being able to keep my eyes open.
Yeah.
But
you were there for a while though, weren't you, Chris, though, so that's off you.
Yeah, so, I mean, I think on Philemon I did wake up a little bit early for the end of the race and stream the second lobby, but I was not able to do that this time.
Yeah.
What's happened since I've been gone?
Not a lot. The F4H car is just keeping it clean and keeping it tidy. is sitting currently fifth in lobby, but he's been letting cars pass and just letting them do their thing whilst maintaining his the pace so that he can just bring the car home safely. Obviously, as we were discussing, F4H is still chasing that elusive endurance TORA Endurance Race Series GT series.
It took the P1 honours, didn't it, at Le Mans? So
yeah.
And it did work hard with Sebring. I think Sebring was they had quite a few problems, so it was good that they won the Le Mans race, and it seems like they're going to be victorious here. Good to see that the Rogue Motorsport car climbing up the field, and it does look like it was worth me pushing on and getting those laps in.
Yeah, definitely. I think the BMW's been really nice. I think we're quite lucky with the technical issue, but a few other teams had technical issues and still pushing on, so good to see a recovery drive initiated amongst all the teams, really.
Currently just over 15 minutes left of the final stint of the TORA Britcar 24 hours.
Slight update to live timing, thanks to Hailfire's M3s from Lobby C. They're the only two results from Lobby C in stint 11, but it does mean that they are still ahead of the GT production battle by 10 miles from the Forza Racing Hungary car, and are looking at 8th place overall. So unfortunately, my prediction of a production GT on the podium has failed to come to fruition.
Good morning forward slash afternoon, Adrian.
Afternoon, Simon.
Yes.
The production GT battle has been very interesting because it is Lobby C that is, well, winning, basically. That is Lobby C's the most important sort of car, important cars just now. The FRH, the Racing Hungary car, is second just now, but they are, as Adrian was saying, about 10 miles behind. But pushing hard, and as we were discussing earlier on as well, the kind of, you know, this is their debut event, much like A1X in Le Mans, and they're looking good for second in their class, so very impressive, very consistent.
So just to carry on with my update, because I'm seeing live timing, but I'm still tired. It's still showing that there's actually 200 cars, not just the amount that actually entered the race. I haven't just got double vision. I seem to have more than double vision. So first is Black Sheep. Just going down, trying to figure out who's second. Ah, Flawed Fish is second. Is that right?
Flawedfish is third, a couple of miles behind M&M, and 1 mile in front of the Turner car, so it's very close for second and third positions.
Just a bit.
We don't think we've seen such close racing. I mean, these guys will be racing right to the end of the line now, because for Le Mans, usually the guys all join together and come across the line at once, but I think they'll be flat out racing all the way.
Yeah.
Production GT, Forza Racing Hungary. I can see are looking for that. I do want to give a massive hats off to Aston Martin Racing 007 car, because they started the race with so many issues. Dan had obviously quite a major issue in the first one, where he rolled the car just after Stowe, and I think even in the second stint he had a bit of an accident as well. But they pushed on, and am I right in thinking they're whereabouts are they?
They should be third in class, I think, third or fourth.
But 1.821 for Forza Racing Hungary. So I'm pretty sure to say that they're safe in wrapping that one up. And it's the HR Turners, Turner number 9 in second, which were first over the course of the early morning.
The HR Turner car is still first currently by 11 miles.
Okay, so rather than me actually naming who's in first, second and third for each class, because I seem to be getting it wrong, I might be getting people a bit too excited when I'm not giving the right information because I'm struggling to read. So, okay, so HR Turner is first with 1.832. Yep, you're very right. So it's a third place for the Aston Martin. Am I reading that right?
Yeah. 007. 1780. Yep, they are still running third overall, even with all the problems. Quite close behind them, though, is the HR Turner Motorsport car, number 951. 1,745 miles.
Okay, 1,7... still about 20-odd miles behind, so unless Aston Martin Racing 007 have a few issues, I'm pretty sure that that's going to be a 1,780. So unless the Aston Martin implodes again on this final stint, I think that's the third place,
which I think Dan will be extremely happy with, especially happened.
Yeah, definitely. So big hats off to them. End of stint one, they were actually dead last, apart from the Rogue Motorsport car, which didn't make it out until stint two. So so really well done to them for climbing all the way back up and pushing on. Clubman, who we got for Clubman?
Clubman is CQR car in the Honda Civic. They are currently running away with it at the front.
And on TV.
The CQR-ish Golf is close behind them, although in this lobby they have fallen back a little bit with their new door. BG Smithy in the Dodge is currently running second overall with his vinyls that have peeled off in the wind. And a broken brake light as well, it seems.
So how long is left?
Currently, just over 10 minutes to go.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Are you sure it's not 27 minutes to go with it being the last stint?
No, they're racing to the 50-minute mark. Because it's up to the diamond's up to 2 hours and 15, and they're racing to 2 hours.
Yep.
So they are racing down to the 50-minute mark that's left, so...
I have started drinking Lucozade as soon as I've woken up to try and get back with it. So, no, you're very right.
Hey, you had a long night.
Oh. I think I actually did very roughly the same kind of shift for Le Mans. But again, because there wasn't those long straights, and I just found it so much more enduring than Le Mans because of traffic and... You know, you're turning a corner so much more often. It's so much more of a tight track. It just felt like I was awake for twice as long.
Yeah, I just did my 4-hour stint when I woke up this morning, and arms were quite sore. Just the amount of turning that you constantly got to do. The I'm not looking forward to Nürburgring.
It's only 8 hours, and I suppose if you've got a team of two drivers, that's only going to be 4 hours each.
You can split that up into 2 hour sections all the way through the day, or you can, if you're brave enough, try and double stint. I'm pretty confident that I won't be double stinting around the Nürburgring.
I was just about to say, I'm just looking at Rusty, and again, I don't know whether it's because I'm tired and he thinks that I'm just whinging a little bit too much about it. Even though I'm saying that I was, and I am, very tired, it doesn't mean I didn't enjoy it.
Currently, 10 minutes to go. We've crossed the 2 p.m. mark. So, we're currently into the 25th hour of the TORA Britcar. We're not as delayed as we were at Le Mans. 10 minutes to go in this stint. I think the C lobby is another 10 minutes or so behind that, so we'll need to wait for the HR Turner car to give us an overall distance, and we will be able to see who has won the production final, GT.
Yeah. Get final positions confirmed. And don't forget, there's actually no racing tonight. There's no Toro races tonight, so
thankfully.
Unless Simon's going to spring a surprise on this. Oh yeah, they're moving all the GT rounds tonight. We'll do a Toro Endurance GT race. Oh dear.
We're having a 24-hour lap endurance race around Le Mans and drag tires again.
I'm actually tempted to say that what the guys are saying is actually false. We've decided that Britcar is now going to be a 30-hour endurance race, so we're going to be racing all the way until 8 p.m. tonight.
Oh, that'd be hell.
That would be very nice, would it? Just...
It's December 8th is what the number ring will be. It's the weekend of the 8th and 9th of December, so keep your diaries free.
This feels a bit sad that it's nearly over again.
I don't know. I can't believe it's already.
It's actually gone so quickly.
All the preparation, all the time, yeah. Just getting ready for everything to come up.
It's not over yet, though. It's still going this week.
It's not over yet.
For another 3 months, the live hub will be redundant.
Not really. We just have to.
Slightly.
Happened with all the numerous races so far. I'm pretty sure Le Mans is going to be in big demands, but I can only assume that there's going to have to be invites for those that have had success in all the numerous races this year, have them invited for next year, and then with the remaining slots, have a pre-qualifying session to make sure that the quickest guys get in, or the best guys get in.
We can still do that, but I think leaving it open for anyone to enter is still probably the fairest way to do it.
It'll still be open, pre-qualifying, enter pre-qualifying, as long as they're quick.
But I think it's with the Nürburgring, it's such a big track that you might not see each other for a while.
No.
But I'm not meaning Nürburgring, I mean anyone can enter Nürburgring, but for next year's Le Mans, there'll have to be something beforehand to make sure that we've got the right amount of lobbies and...
Well, yeah, that we're going to have to work very hard for whatever endurance races we do now to make sure we have got lobby hosts. XBR is very, we're really thankful that they've put the time into it. They have offered to run Lobby C for us throughout the day, but yeah. Without them doing it, we wouldn't have had anyone.
Nah, we would have been pretty much fubar'd.
So, it depends on how many hosts that we can give out to other lobbies. If we're running in teams of two, the staff, the stewards, the marshals and all that kind of stuff, we might be able to cover a lot more lobbies, but it all depends who's interested in racing at the Nürburgring as well.
And I'm pretty sure once we've dropped the checker flag, we're going to get all the numbers together and then we'll give you a roundup of exactly who finished where. So to summarise, if which black sheep's the lead overall, have had the lead for at least 20 of the 24 hours. You're looking at Vodafone British Gamers did take the lead some point early in the race, but then fell back and also lost connection during stint number 5. M&M Racing have held on to second place for as much as possible. They're still there. The Hailfire Turner car still in third place according to my timing. Floyd Fish Motorsport not so far behind Lobby B. As for GT Production, Hailfire Turner still leading ahead of the Forza Racing Hungary car, which has gradually got into second place throughout the day. The Aston Martin 007 car was due to be leading from the off, but had a massive crash in the first hour and has recovered to get third place in that class. And for Clubman, it's been CQR dominance throughout the race. Ever since the start, it's been the Ignamoni Civic out front, followed by the CQRish car. We've seen them battling throughout the stints, but it is a lap 8 miles ahead for the Ignamoni Civic after the 11th stint, and I'm pretty sure it's going to stay like that for the final stint. And now focusing on what I thought looked to be a green BMW Hailfire car, but it's the it's covered in coal soot as has been throughout the race. I think they'll probably give that one more clean over so it can get back to America to celebrate the win.
less than 5 minutes to go in the final stint of the Le Mans, the Britcar 24 hours. All this talk about Le Mans. Currently just watched a Hailfire Turner car go slightly wide as trying to pass CQRS Golf.
Must say huge thanks to all the teams and drivers that have taken part so far. It's made a really good event. I mean, the lobby's been really good fun, a bit lively, but really good fun, good banter, and helps get you through the stint as well. So thanks to everyone taking part so far.
Yep, as we said, we'd be here without you guys actually racing here.
Yep, would be just being Richie and Simon, Adrian commenting on cars.
Which is why I've been going slightly mad.
Oh dear.
Let's do it all over again next weekend.
No.
Oh, we kind of are.
We can, but we won't do anything. We'll just watch.
We'll be speaking for 24 hours solid on a race. We'll just be speaking to people for 24 hours solid.
As far as the media side of things are concerned, that's it. We're going to try and at least do one thing live from Silverstone if we can. Maybe we'll get a podcast in here or there. I'm assuming that one could possibly be made on the Wednesday before we all eventually meet up at Silverstone.
No, I think the podcasting went depending on time frames. I think with the definitely doing media things, particularly bringing video cameras. Simon's going to try and do some like loading some live footage as well while we're there. Biggest thing, just get your if you can get down to Silverstone for next weekend, I've got some on Saturday or Sunday. Just come down and say hello, and we can't wait. It'll be a really good fun.
It's going to be good. Really looking forward to it.
Yep, and next year. We're in Spa next year because I've got to think about my calendar and stuff next year.
That was in August. That was the end of August. That was. So it'll probably be the same thing again.
Yeah, so Spa could be a good one next year for me.
Brief discussion before we go into this one in the last 2 minutes. People are always looking to extend the endurance calendar with TORA. Four events is pretty much as flat out. It takes a lot of organising to do these kind of things. We will probably talk about what we're going to do next year. The thing is though, Sebring, Le Mans, the Britcar and the Nürburgring are pretty much stables though, aren't they? That's quite, everybody knows about them.
Well, I suppose if we want to enhance the international appeal, we could actually shift from Silverstone to a completely different venue.
I like the idea of the Suzuka 1000 kilometres. That would be great fun to do at some point. And it's not going to be quite as long as these, so we may look at doing that, but it's going to take a lot of moving about.
Yeah.
As a slight suggestion for it, you could possibly have our long...
I was just about to say the same thing, Nick James.
Yeah, pity the Mike Road Lancer as well. That could be another one we could do next year. Also, Simon's going to be working on special maybe so we can care. As well to fill your endurance needs as well throughout the year. So
am I? Oh yes.
Possibly.
That is the teams now starting to cross the line for their final laps, or the final lap.
Well, so that means if the time is up, then the FOH Black Sheep car is eventually going to cross the line.
The Black Sheep car will cross the line with maybe with a lap to spare. 50 seconds to go, just coming out through bridge.
I'll say a huge thanks to everyone who's taking part.
He could technically slow right down if he's instructed.
He could. He might want to get an extra lap in, he may just slow down for it. A lot of cars are now on their final lap, 30 seconds to go as he comes out of the final corner. I think he's still going for it.
So the car that won the Nürburgring 24 last year at the hands of ATR Dan. Set to win another endurance race. Once again, it's the same team that won the Le Mans 24 Hours for TORA this year, and have played a very dominant part in that event too, in one of these cars as well as a Chevrolet Corvette and GTs.
F4H car has, it's now on its last lap. That is the timer run out. The cars are all slowing down, I think a few cars are slowing down for some formation flying.
I certainly hope so. There's not going to be any team formation because the F4H car is the only car.
No, there's an F4H production car. I don't know where he is on track. I think he may already be...
Is the Acura literally about 10 seconds ahead of...
The F4H on the Mopar track. In the Acura has crossed the line.
Crossed the line.
So
right.
No formation flying from him.
No team formation flying at least, but I think everyone's going to hold back now and let the Ford GT cross the line ahead of them.
Okay, so just give a few minutes, five or 10 minutes for the results to come in, and then we'll give a final confirmation. It's all going to depend on Lobby C for some positions in the championship, but...
Yep, need to get Lobby B updated as well, so I don't know if someone can go and try and find that.
Well, all the lobbies need to be updated, really. It's the fight per car closed in on the British game of Ferrari, which has been a potential threat, not just to the Ford car, but also the CQR Jaguar, which...
And as we watch the F4H car coming round to cross the line after 24 incredible hours of racing,
definitely
the F4H Faith Palmer has brought the car home. Incredible, absolutely incredible.
Well done to team F4H, that's been a dominant win. Really, really good stuff and fantastic effort there.
So, before we come back and give you the full rundown, we will take a short break there. Thanks for watching, but keep an eye out for the results soon.